Hello guys, good evening. Once again, I am here to basically give you a session on Azure DevOps. Basically, we are going to see how we can actually build a complete CI and CD pipeline for deploying our application in cloud. Yes. For this particular demo, I am going to use .NET Core project, and I'm going to deploy the project in Azure App Services, the most modern things in Microsoft community. But let me at the same time add that this particular topic is not at all going to have any kind of, I would say, inclination to only .NET. Azure DevOps is for everything. You can use Azure DevOps for Java projects, Python projects, PHP projects, any kind of project you are developing, you can actually make Azure DevOps as a tool for you to deploy your applications. So yes, I'm pretty sure this is going to be a very constructive journey which you are going to have with me on how can a developer benefit? How can an administrator benefit? How can an IT team benefit when they make use of certain DevOps tools? Of course, I'm going to use Azure DevOps, all the tools provided by Microsoft in Azure DevOps portal. That is what is going to be my primary focus upon. But yes, before I actually start my session, I would want to probably know here, how many of you have ever tasted DevOps? Probably you might have worked on DevOps in the past. You at least have got some experience of somebody else using the terminology related to DevOps. Can you please write this in the chat window? What is your past experience about Azure DevOps? And what is your opinion about it? What are the pros? What are the cons? What are the benefits? What are the limitations? What is your experience? I want to hear that before I actually give you a complete journey from beginning to end. We'll have a full-fledged journey from beginning to end about Azure DevOps today. Yes, I'm actually already live and I've already started the session. I'm yet to show you what exactly we want to do. I'll try to also provide at the end of the session a link to you from where you can actually download this particular document, the one which I'm using for this particular session. You can download this. So my request to you is, give me some experiences about DevOps, what you have. Okay, I see a few messages already there. How to make career in DevOps? Please tell steps. Okay, these are the questions. Voice is low. Okay, let me check. Voice is low. Audio input capture. I think it's decently shows here. Can somebody confirm that the voice is decently good enough? Yeah, to me everything looks good. So audio input. Okay, great. Maybe you have to increase the volume. I don't have any provision to directly increase the volume, guys. So please check up at your end. You should have lowered the volume at your end. I don't have any option of increasing the volume. Okay, great. The voice is good. Yep. So how many of you audio is good? I learned DevOps and certified, but don't have hands-on experience. A common problem most of the people in the industry have today. Best things to mapping your task and mapping the build automatically. Fantastic. Okay. Okay. Let's start. I think we are good enough. We have decent number of participants to start the session. Yeah, don't feel shy at any point of time to give me a like. And also don't please forget to subscribe to our channel and click on that bell icon so that you can get more notifications about the webinars which we are going to have in the coming days. Right, so let's begin our journey first with a very brief introduction to what is Azure DevOps. Followed by that, I'm going to show you how a complete project lifecycle is when we have a DevOps being included in the project development. Yes, how do we actually build a CI and CD pipeline? And then we will get into the practical aspects where I'm going to talk about all these things one after the other. So let me get rid of these small spelling mistake errors. Perfect. Yes. So we are going to begin with a quick overview of DevOps. Create Azure DevOps organization in DevOps portal. Followed by that, create a project. And then in Azure portal, I'm going to create an app service. I'll have three app service instances. One I'll use for development, one I'm going to use for QA, and one for production. And I want to actually demonstrate how step by step one will be able to move the complete application from dev environment to the QA environment to the production environment. And definitely we also want to have some kind of process where the approvals will be required. Some validations can be performed. Those things also we will see how we can add over here. Yes, in this particular session, I am taking .NET Core as the base, but I told you before, it's not necessary that we should use .NET Core only. It can be any other language also. Maybe Java, Python, PHP, Ruby, any language you can use. And any platform you can use. So, how to build a CI and CD pipeline. And finally, we are going to also add an approval process for ensuring that the product goes into live smoothly. So if you talk about Azure DevOps, in particular Azure DevOps, these are the five services which Azure DevOps is going to provide us. Azure boards, where the complete planning can be documented, where you are going to create your work items, where if the project has already started, maybe the testing team is going to add defects. It basically provides you a Kanban board where you can even prioritize your items and see them in the complete project lifecycle. We are going to have Azure repos, basically a Git repository. Though yes, it also supports Team Foundation version control, but the world has already moved on to Git. So Azure repos is a repository where we are going to manage the version of our software. We have Azure pipelines where we are going to create a CI and CD pipeline. The most important, the heart of actually DevOps, the pipelines. Azure test plans. You can actually, as a test engineer, create your plans there. You can include your manual and exploratory testing. You can even go for continuous testing integration over there. You can see the test results. And of course, if at all you are into building reusable components, you may also want to make use of Azure artifacts. If you are working with Java, it will be Maven. If you're working with .NET, it will be NuGet packages. If you're working with JavaScript, NPM, Node.js npm packages. Python Py is also one more which Python people uses. So even if you have reusable components, they can also be part of Azure artifacts from where the organization can make use of in building their project. And of course, if you are participating in developing some reusable component, you may want to publish it into Azure artifact as the end goal. Yes, I repeat this point. Azure DevOps is all about these five items: working with Azure boards, Azure repos, Azure pipeline, Azure test plans, Azure artifacts. If at all one has to expertise in Azure DevOps, these five items is what they are supposed to expertise in. But before I go into hands-on and give you complete practical experience, let me take you through a journey of how a development is started, even before actually how things start in a project, and eventually a final end goal of deploying your application for the end user happens. So let us start. It's a very beautiful diagram. Subhashakar.com is where I have taken this from. I want to give extraordinary credit to this fellow. I have just picked up and I'm talking about it, but excellent document this is. Let us say it all starts with customer. Customer gets an idea, his bulb clicks. Nowadays, a lot of customers have a lot of ideas. And these ideas stay for a very short period of time. We all know that. An idea comes, and if you don't give an energy to the idea is gone. It's no more there. But there are few people in this world who have an idea and they keep giving some energy to this idea, and a stage comes where they decide to implement it. Definitely, by that time itself, they should have documented certain things. And now they need a team who can convert that idea into a software, which the customers can make use of. This is my customer. I'm a development company. My customer got an idea. He comes to me. I build the idea, I build a software for him so that his customers can take the benefit out of it. Blah, 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 blah. Let's not get into that story. But point is very simple. Unless something is documented, unless something is written onto the paper, it is not going to get organized. That is where the Azure boards come into the picture. This Azure boards is the place where we can add our work items. Basically, you can start with use cases what the customer wants to actually build. As an administrator, this is the task. As an end user, these are the things the product is supposed to do. The mobile version is supposed to do this. The desktop version, complete planning, let us say, is supposed to happen between the customer and the business analyst. And they are supposed to translate the complete set of requirements into a series of backlogs. Backlogs, we all know, what we did not pass are backlogs. So we have a backlog of items. Using those backlog of items, now we have to do a mapping. Now I have a team of engineers in my organization. Some people are expert in designing. Some people are probably expert in content writing. Some people are probably expert in programming, which again can be further server-side programming, client-side programming. Some people are expert in maybe testing. Some people are the one who would actually take care of my IT infrastructure. So yes, I'm going to now break up all these people into different teams. We are calling them as engineering teams. And for all these teams, we are going to create sprint and we will do some kind of capacity planning. I know there are four developers and each of these developers is going to provide me maybe 6 hours in a day. So I have something like 6 into 4, 24 hours in a day, multiply by the number of working days. And maybe I'll come up with a 15 days sprint. Worst cases, maybe 30 days sprint. But usually the standard practice followed is 15 days a sprint is created. So basically how it is happening, a very large project, we are trying to break into multiple deliverable units. We don't want a client to see a surprise. Client wanted an apple, but by the time he is getting delivered the product, it becomes an orange. Then what will happen? Either the client or the development team is a banana. No, we don't want bananas. We want, if apple is requested, an apple to be delivered. If an orange is requested, an orange is to be delivered. We don't want bananas here. So guys, how can we ensure that the client has requested for something and he is getting precisely what he has requested? Keep showing him what you are doing on a regular basis. Keep taking feedback from the client. Client may even go to the extent of seeing something and completely discarding what has been developed and giving a new set of specs. Welcome it. That's what is all agile programming is about, and that's what's working today. So the first stage of every project lifecycle is taking the requirements from the client, understanding them properly, creating a backlog of items, and assigning this backlog of items to the teams and individuals within the team through some proper capacity planning. Yes, that's what happens in Azure boards. There will be Kanban boards which are created. Now that the items have been already assigned, the developer will pick up the item. As soon as the developer picks up the item, which can be a new item in development, or it can be a bug from a previous sprint, he is going to pick up a particular work item from the development, from the list of backlogs which are provided. And keeping that requirement in mind, he will start writing code. Yes, he might be using .NET, he might be using Java, he might be using Python, he might be using simple Node.js, JavaScript, whatever. There is a story picked up and that has to be now developed. He uses his programming abilities and he is going to convert the whole program into an executable output. Yes, he will also test it on his local machine, but something very important. He is not developing this alone. One developer, if has picked up one feature in a given sprint, probably other developers have picked up other features in the same sprint. And at the end of the sprint, all these people will have to combine and produce the output. That means there is a parallel development happening on individual machines, and ultimately it has to all merge at one place. And developers don't want surprise. Individually, his feature works good, but when it gets merged with another developer's code, the bomb blast, boom. No, they also don't want the surprises. So even they want on a regular basis to see how their code is going to merge with the other developer's code. How collective output is going to be deployed on various environments. So definitely we need now a system which is going to manage our source code, which is going to help us in building individually, but ultimately collaborating with the co-developers. And not only that, we also want some expert developers to take care of code reviews. I write code, but what's the guarantee I'm the best programmer? Somebody who has better experience than me probably can guide me and say, hey, Sandeep, you have not done this correctly and you have to make these changes. This is not the right way of writing the algorithm. And if you change the algorithm and implement it in this way, or maybe if you use this feature of the language, the application is going to be more fantastic. So we want code reviewers. Basically, in the team only, there are people who can probably improvise our code and make it better. by giving some feedback. So we want them also to come into the picture. So Azure Repos is a source control management repository where all the code is going to get merged into my code, another developer code, where the reviews are going to happen, where the version of my code is going to be maintained. If I by chance want to go back and see, oh, what did I do the day before? Probably that was better code. Let me actually roll back what I have done. I want to do that. I want these kind of facilities, and that is when I actually go for something like Azure Repos. Of course, Azure Repos has substitutes which are provided by Microsoft themselves, GitHub. GitHub is also a source code repository. You do have Bitbucket, and many more Git repositories are available in the market, which probably people use for managing their source code. But Azure Repos is the one which is part of Azure DevOps. Good. Now that the code has come into Azure Repos, I want to see now how does it merge, build together, and gets deployed onto a particular machine. Let's call it as a development machine to begin with, and then test it. That is where comes the pipelines. Two types of pipelines we have. Continuous integration, CI pipeline. Continuous delivery, CD pipeline. CI/CD pipelines are what we are going to build for this purpose. So what are the CI/CD pipelines doing? Automation of the build. What a developer does on his machine, only with his code, we want that to be done on a particular agent machine and a separate machine altogether where the code from all the developer comes in. Everything is merged, and on one separate machine, the build is supposed to happen. The source code is supposed to be compiled into a format which is executable. That's what is done by a CD pipeline. And of course, a CD pipeline probably does little more. CD pipeline is not only going to do a build, but also it is going to test your code, maybe unit testing. Check whether the code which you have written is properly functioning or not. Is the logic implemented perfectly or not? And like that, so many other things which probably we would want to do in a continuous integration pipeline, for which we might use tools provided by even third parties, Sonar Cube, Sonar Cloud, White Source Security, which is basically taking care of the licensing or vulnerabilities in your code, if any. It will detect that and it will prompt us. So yes, the developers are going to write the code which will all get merged. The code reviewers will perform pull request, and once the pull request is completed, there will be a build performed. Build will be tested, the output will be tested, and if there are no more errors in that, yes, it will go through various other phases. It depends on how many phases you want to add, and eventually we are going to generate something called as artifacts. These are referred as build artifacts. These build artifacts, on successful build and unit testing, we are going to now deploy to a target environment. Who is going to deploy? That is done by a separate CD pipeline. So the CD pipeline is responsible for taking our build output and first putting it on a dev box where the developers can perform testing. I can test my piece of functionality. My code developer can test his piece of functionality. And when we all are convinced, somebody might be our team lead is responsible for providing an approval process where the artifacts which were generated here would go to the next environment. But possibility is there that once it is deployed into an environment, development you call it or testing you call it, we can probably find certain bugs. There will be a testing team which will start testing the application. And if they find any bugs, what they do? Bugs have to be tracked properly. Again, all these things will go into the Azure boards. Logging of all the bugs is going to happen. Once the bugs are all provided here, Maybe in the next sprint, maybe in the same sprint, based on how the decisions are taken, they would again go through the whole cycle. But yes, at one point of time, the testers are satisfied and they say, oh, fantastic, there are no more bugs, at least to our knowledge at this point of time. Let us move it into the upper environment. The testing team is now then going to move it into, let us say, UAT environment. You may have multiple environments in between, but let's say user acceptance testing has been now initiated, where the business users, maybe the friends of the customer or the people who are working for the customer, they are going to perform testing of the application. Like an end user, they are going to find. If at all they find again any defects, all those defects will get logged into Azure boards. But if they don't find any defect, they are satisfied, they would want to promote the application and move it into the production environment. And ultimately, the customer's customer, what I initiated, the whole requirement was for whom? My customer's customer, they will start using the application in production. Advantage is, by the time it goes into production, the code has already followed a process. The code has already gone through various stages. It has been ensured that there are no bugs and everything is fantastic. So a perfect life cycle is what happens. And of course, this can keep repeating sprint after sprint till the list of all sprints get exhausted, till there are no more bugs available in Azure boards as backlogs. Basically, it's all about clearing the backlogs. And the day the backlogs are completed, probably we can say the project is completed. Of course, nowadays that never happens. Every project is almost an ongoing process. It's a continuous process we keep doing every day. But yes, the whole team may not be required. We might need only a maintenance team. We might need only certain issues which are day-to-day activities, probably needs to be changed. So there are many, many, many tools which are going to come into the picture here. There might be not only tools which are provided by Microsoft, there are third-party tools also which will come into the picture. Azure DevOps is so nice and perfect that it doesn't limit you to only use the tools and services which are provided by Microsoft. They say we are supermarket. We will sell our product and we will also give you an opportunity to showcase the other products. The customers of Azure DevOps have a choice whether they want to use these products which are by Microsoft or they want to use the products and services which are probably by third party or even open source community. Some people would want to use for CI a Jenkins pipeline. Jenkins has been there for years, very popular for building CI/CD pipeline. So you use the rest of Azure DevOps infrastructure. You use the complete ecosystem of Azure DevOps, but Jenkins you try to bring it into the picture. You want to do some kind of configuration management, you bring Ansible into the picture. You deploy not only into Microsoft Azure, the deployment can also happen into AWS. The deployment can happen into Google. Deployment can happen even in your on-premise environment. It's actually your choice where you want to deploy your application. So Microsoft doesn't insist that you must stick to only Microsoft tools, Microsoft services, Microsoft languages when you're making use of Azure DevOps. And this is one of the major reasons why DevOps is catching up so fast in the industry. So now that you understand this end-to-end life cycle, precisely my attempt will be also to show you the same thing. But let us see how are these CI and CD pipelines constructed before I actually get into the practicals. So yes, we have got board from where the developer is going to pick up a particular backlog, a work item, based on which he is going to write the code and merge his code into the Git repository, maybe with the help of push command, or for that matter, it can even go through a pull request. Ultimately, the code goes into one of the branch in a Azure repo. from that branch, a build pipeline will get triggered. Yes, you have a choice of automated trigger. You have a choice of manual trigger. It's up to you. Once the build pipeline is triggered, the code will be pulled onto a special machine, which we call it as an agent machine. From there, it will be taken into the, if on the agent machine, the required softwares will be installed, because you need to build the project. To build the project, you might need the software which will be used for building it. Something like SDK softwares will be required. For testing, you'll need some additional tools. All that is going to happen in install tools. From there, it goes into, let us say, a build solution. Final build action is going to happen. Test cases will be performed. All the unit testings will be done. Package artifacts will be created. And these artifacts will be published so that they get saved into Azure repos. So the result of this build pipeline or build job, we can say, is an Azure artifact. Once we have this Azure artifact, we may automatically trigger a CD pipeline. Immediate, no delay, no human intervention. Oh, CI pipeline is complete. Without any intervention, without any additional requirement, we can simply move to a CD pipeline. Possibility is there. CD pipeline will first deploy the source code into a dev box. From the dev box, it will deploy into a QA box. These are what? In the diagram, at least I'm showing web apps, which are basically Azure app services. But these can be virtual machines. These can be physical machines in your on-premise environment. So you have a development environment, QA environment, production environment. Production environment, we don't want to directly deploy, because during deployment, I don't want, as the files are getting replaced, the old files are getting replaced with the new files, I do not want my site to go down. I want 24/7 operation. So we may want to do something called as blue-green deployment. We may want to go for canary deployment. For all these things, we use feature called as staging slots. I will first deploy into a slot where the project is going to get warmed up. And after the warm-up is done, I would actually move quickly without any downtime from staging slot into the production slot. So yes, a deployment of application in production should always be first into staging and then swap it with production. This is what I'm trying to actually show you here. I may not want to get into Azure boards. We'll start our journey with, we will use developer, build the code, build a CI pipeline, build the CD pipeline, and all this is what precisely I'm going to demonstrate to you people now. But before I proceed, I would definitely love to see certain questions if there are. I see not many questions here. Why are you teaching .NET? What is this? Using Azure DevOps for our subscription automation. Okay, good. CI/CD step is implementing with YAML. Yeah, there are two ways of implementing CI and CD step. One is the classic, and the other is YAML. Of course, in this particular session, I'm doing CI/CD with classic editor, but maybe some other time I'll take the opportunity to even demonstrate to you how YAML can be used, yet another markup language. What is Bitbucket? Bitbucket is one more repository by Atlassian. It's another organization. Atlassian provides Bitbucket, and most of the time people use Bitbucket for their on-premise application development. It's a code repository which supports Git. Git is the base on top of which GitHub, Azure repos, Bitbucket, all these are UI repositories which are managing your source code using Git in background. Good. Can you repeat what is CI and CD once again? Continuous integration, continuous deployment, automation of ensuring that our code gets swiftly deployed from a repository into the production. That whole process is what we call it as a pipeline. So how a water flows through the pipeline, like that our code is going to flow through the pipeline. The origin from where it is taken is Azure repos. The target where it is deployed is actually your service, app service, production service. So let us see all these things in action now. So here I have given you the steps in case you want to use them, but I'm going to perform all these steps one by one in sequence. First, let us set up our environment. We want to set up our environment such that we have Azure DevOps, we have even Azure App Services created. So first I would like to go to portal.azure.com, login into my account, and here I would like to create the resource, and I would like to begin with creating a web app. Create a web app, use some subscription. I'll create a new resource group. Webinar demo RG, and here I'll give the code runtime stack. I want to use .NET Core 3.1. Windows is fine, Linux is fine, anything is okay, doesn't really matter. Choose your region. I generally prefer East US and no specific reason. Choose your pricing tier. I'll leave the default values. You can enable App Insight in case you want. I will say no, I'm not interested. I'm actually not really concentrating on the app service. Some validation failed. Okay, the most important we need to give Hello World app. I'll call it as Hello World app, but hopefully that may not be available. Yep, so we will say DSS Hello World app. So my website ultimately is going to be DSS Hello World app dot Azure websites dot net. But as I said, I want to have multiple environments created. First, I would like to have dev. Followed by the dev, I would like to probably do testing, or let us call it as UAT. And then we will have the final production in which we are going to have even slots. So I say review and create now. Yes, let's say the dev environment is getting created, and in the meantime, I go to app services, create one more app service. I would use the same resource group. It's your choice. You may not want to use the same resource group. This time I'll call it as UAT, just the naming convention I'm following so that it's easy. Same thing, I may decide to use the same pricing tier or a different pricing tier. It's up to you. If you don't want an interference of one with the other, you may go for a different pricing tier. And once I start creating this, the final thing I would have to do is create a production version. Perfect. Go back to app services. The first one is already ready. Create one more. this is my production. So I'll not change this URL. I will not put here hyphen prod. I'll just leave it as default. 3.1 East US. Use the existing pricing tier only. For demo purpose, it is fine. But generally, what can happen is you might use one pricing tier for testing and development and maybe UAT, and a separate independent pricing tier you might use for production. Click on create. The most important thing is once this production version is created, I would also need to create a staging slot in that, because ultimately we want to deploy to a staging slot first and then swap it into the production. Two-step process, that is. So yeah, we may probably do that little later as this is taking time. But in the meantime, now I go to dev.azure.com, and dev.azure.com is where I'll create a new organization. I'll call this as DSS Webinar Demo Org. Any name you can give, actually. But I'm creating a new organization in Azure DevOps. And based on that organization name, we are going to have a URL now. dev.azure.com DSS Webinar Org. In this particular organization, we can have multiple projects. Remember, these are DevOps projects. So minimum thing you'll have to do when you're working with a project, complete project, whatever I have explained to you, this whole thing can be managed by one DevOps project. So I'll call that as Hello World App. You decide you want to keep it as public repository, you want to keep it as private repository. If it is an open source project and you want others to pull your project and probably continue development from where you would leave, then you may go for public. But if you want to keep it private and only through some username and password provide access to various people, then you would go for private project. I create a project, 1-2 seconds, and it's ready. The project is ready. And you can see here we have got boards. We can add our work items, which can be epics, issues, tasks. You can see your Kanban board. You can see the list of backlogs, if any. You can do sprint planning and so on. This is the part I'm skipping for now. We'll go into repos. This is where my repository is. Right now, there are no source code. Of course, I want to upload source code from my machine into this repository. How am I going to do this? Let's do a development on the local machine. And for this, I'm going to use, as I said, .NET Core. So d:, I create some directory, webinar, demo, cd, and here I would like to create a new .NET Core project, for which we have to execute a series of commands. I would just want to quickly copy and paste from my handout. These are the commands I would like to just quickly paste it. First, we will create a new solution. Hello World App is the name of the solution I'm giving. Those who do not understand .NET, probably you don't need to really worry much about it. And those who understand, it's pretty straightforward. So I have a solution created. I go to the solution. And in the solution now, I'll create a new MVC project. And the name of that maybe we want to give is Hello World App, the web part of it. We may have .web, .test, .libraries, and like that, multiple things can be there in the same project. I mean, same solution. So solution basically is made up of multiple projects. But right now, the project is independently created. I would like to actually add the complete project to the solution, which is SLN add, which is in my Hello World app slash web slash csproj. I want to add the project to the solution. Perfect. Perform a build. This is the local build. And when you build the project on my local machine, I'm building it. Successful, everything is good. You can go to the project folder. This is where the project is. The most important thing is here we have got bin. We can go to bin. We can go to debug.net. And here you'll find the DLL file. This is the one which is my primary executable in .NET Core. So like in Java, people do Java and give the dot class file name. Here we give the .dll. Fantastic. The web server is running. Copy this. Put it in the browser. I'm able to see the output not coming correctly. The reason being, if it is a .NET project, you're not supposed to run from any folder. You have to specifically run the project from the project folder. So I'll now give .NET, basically path matters. Bin, debug, .NET Core 3.1, and in that, Hello World app dot web dot dll. Now if I refresh this, you'll see proper CSS is also implemented. You can navigate. Good. If you want, you can even make changes. But right now I'm alone developing. How do I somehow ensure that this project which I am developing goes into the repository? It has to go into the Azure repository. So for this, we will have to do first, I'm using Visual Studio Code as my editor. Here we can do editing of our code. We may go to probably controllers, make changes to the code. We may go to views, home, index.cshtml, welcome to Azure DevOps, blah, blah, blah. But most important thing which I would like to do here is add to my project a file by name gitignore. So just add here dot, no, I would like to add it to the root. I don't want it to be under gitignore. I want it to be actually in the same directory where I have the solution file. Right now this is in web folder. That's not my requirement, so I'm actually in the wrong folder now. Let me exit. I will delete this file. Exit. We are in the web folder. We should go to the solution folder, because today right now we have only one project, but tomorrow we may have multiple projects, and all these projects we want to move into the repository. So from here, you can say code dot to open studio code. Add here gitignore dot gitignore. I want to ignore bin. I want to ignore debug. I don't want these folders to be part of my repository. Save it. Close it. Now let's initialize git repository on the local machine. Right now we have not done any git initialization. So git init is the command which is going to create a git repository in the local machine. Now, once we have the Git repository, you can actually say Git status and see these are the things which we need to commit. I'm right now working with local repository. So there are Git commands, Git add dot, everything which we modified has been staged. Git commit hyphen m, initial commit, the changes have been committed. And once these changes are committed, I can now say Git status, we are on the master branch and everything is perfect, nothing to commit. Yeah, you may want to do code dot, make changes, edit some file, maybe I'll just for display purpose, it's easy for you to understand. Edit this, just put three dots, save it, close it. Again, same story, Git add, Git commit, minus m, I would say title changed, I would say Git log, and you'll see there are two commits. This is the first commit when I change the title first time, this is the second commit when I change the title second time. Rather, this is the first time commit, this is the base. And now my local repository is tracking all the changes. But what is important? I want to move these changes into the remote. So how are we going to move this all changes into the remote? Now let's go back to the DevOps project which we created. And here, push an existing repository from command line. These are the two commands. Just copy them as it is and paste it. Enter. Definitely, I'm not explaining all the commands in details, guys. Because of the time constraint, it's a demo of all the steps. But there is a big story which is happening behind the scene, which I'm not going into the details. So here I have sandeepsoni@deckensoft.com, my login ID, which has permission to that particular repository. And everything is pushed. Verify. How? Come here. Refresh the files. And you'll see the same source code is present. And you'll also find the commit changes, the two commits. Yeah, you may want to probably go back, continue your development, make further changes to the code. Welcome to Azure DevOps, and maybe add here Azure repos. Save it, come back, stage the changes, commit the changes. And do Git push. Push your content to the server. So basically, right now I'm using all Git commands. Yes, definitely there is a proper learning curve required for you. I have seen most of the people in the industry use Git without even knowing that there are Git commands executing in the background. No. Whatever I am doing so far, of course, should be an expertization of a developer. Developer should and must know all these things. I'm giving you what? Very small content. There's a big list of Git commands which probably you should know and even know how to optimize things. So there is a learning curve here to learn all the Git commands. Now, once you know all the Git commands, now let us first see here what happened. Wow, repository updated. So can I say I am doing this like that other developer? Everybody is pushing their code into this centralized repository. Possibility is there. For example, just to give you a hint, I probably create one more. For demo purpose, I am doing it on my machine itself. I create some temp folder. And in temp folder, I'll just create one dummy folder. Empty. Here I would like to get that code from the remote. How do I do it? Go here to the repository, clone it. Let's say another developer is doing this. Copy the URL. the other developer now will say git clone and give the URL. Because I'm doing it on the same machine, it's not going to ask me for username and password because it's going to do caching of it. But if it was a different machine, it will ask you for the username and password, and those username and passwords can be an account which has permission on Azure repos created in the organization, that particular user, or it can be even this particular user. I can give this also. I have to share with the other developer this username and this password, and he will pull the code into his local machine. Now you see, I have a folder created, and same thing is here. Imagine for now that this is another developer working. So I have two developers working, one developer working on this repository, local repository, a different developer working on a different local repository. And what this developer does, okay, he says, I'm going to make my changes to the project. He will add probably his own content, and definitely you will have a question, Sandeep, what if there is a conflict? Yes, that is a separate learning curve you'll have to go through. There can always be some additional conflict. I am developer 2. Save it. Close it. And he will now want to, same story, git add, git commit, and of course he will say, same story, git push origin master. Gone. Let's see if everybody's code is here. Yep, we see everything here. So these three were by developer one, this is by developer two, and everything got merged. And you can actually look at the files. You will see we have here the file which I modified in views home index.cshtml. Developer 2, welcome to. Fantastic. What did we achieve? Multiple developers working and all of them pushing their code into a centralized Azure repos. I repeat, Azure repos is not mandatory. I could also replace Azure repos with GitHub. Any source code repository is fine. Now that our code is into the repository, let's see the next step of how we can actually build a CI pipeline, continuous integration pipeline. And this continuous integration pipeline is going to build my project, taking the source code from the repository, which can be Azure repos, Bitbucket, GitHub, Git Enterprise, other Git. If you are using YAML, which is actually the modern way of doing it, but I'm not demonstrating in these sessions. But when I'm teaching, actually, I actually teach YAML more than probably Classic. Classic is good enough for beginners, but in real time, people use YAML today. But to keep long short story short, to just show you the power, I would prefer using Azure Classic Editor. Here we need to mention from which project, which team project, which repository, and which branch of that repository. So yes, there is a big story which somebody needs to know, how to work with multiple branches. There will be a master branch, there will be a development branch, there will be a feature branch. Feature branches will merge into the master branch. Master branch may merge into probably a release branch. Release branch goes into the master branch ultimately. That is something which again is a big subject of discussion in branching policies. Every organization has their own ways of doing it with pros and cons based on their situation. So yes, a DevOps engineer has to also participate in those branching policies. And for that reason, that fellow should be expert in all Git commands. How probably pull requests will be created, how pull requests must be authorized, how the pull request must be approved. So many things are there which are as a part of process. Here we are not doing that, of course. Yes, then we now go to continue. Here they are ready-made templates. I want to simply use .NET Core template. My project is .NET Core. If you are using .NET framework, you might use your .NET Core, .NET framework. It's your choice. If you're working with containers, use this. Docker containers, use this. Azure Functions, if you want to deploy. Jenkins also, you can integrate with. Node.js projects, Xamarin web apps, Universal Windows Programming, UWP apps, Python applications. So many options are there. Even desktop applications. As of now, we just want .NET Core apply. So these are the steps a .NET developer has to go through. Restore, build, test, publish, and finally publish the artifact. These are precisely the same steps here. Get source, install tools. Yes, the agent which I'm going to use here will have built-in tools, we don't need it. Build solution, these are the build solution steps. Run test cases, publish artifacts, and package it. So one-on-one. Fortunately, in this particular case, it automatically generated, because I used the template, it automatically generated these steps, but you can always add more steps from the gallery. This is a gallery of tasks. One can simply use a particular task from the gallery. You have a choice. And the gallery is there with also a facility to even add your own custom task in the gallery in case you want. Right now, I'm not going into these details also. We are fine. And we don't have test project, so you can simply disable this step. Every task has some configuration. What is the project which has to be compiled? What is the type of build configuration? A variable. So here you can see there is a variable. What is the output directory? Something called as build.artifact staging directory. And from the artifact staging directory, we are taking the content and publishing it into an artifact whose name is drop. So ultimately, when this pipeline is going to execute, we will have an artifact by name drop created, managed by the run. So I say save and queue. You can give some comment in case you want to. Decide what type of agent you want for running the script. Because it is a .NET Core project, you have a choice of either using .NET framework or using .NET anything. It's up to you. Save and run. Fantastic. The agent job is running. And I'll wait for this job to complete. It's waiting for a machine where it can do the compilation. It acquired from Microsoft. The build steps are going to execute. Here all the commands are executed. The code is built, published. Once the build is completed, code is published, artifact generated, and finished. Wow, everything is ready. Yes, you can even look at the artifact at this point of time. You may want to download it and see on your machine what is this. Click on that, download it. And you'll notice that it's a published output of a .NET Core project, which eventually we want to move into a app service. So this has completed the task of moving the application into moving the application into a zip file, but we haven't deployed into app service. Most important thing. We need to now move this into app service and multiple places of app service. We may want to deploy into development branch, we may want to deploy into production branch, we may multiple environments we would like to, and at different times. And all this also should be automated. Right now, what is that I'm doing? I go to a pipeline, and in the pipeline, I'll have to run the pipeline manually. No, I don't want to run the pipeline manually. As soon as the changes are committed, I want the pipeline to run automatically. Yes, you can do that. Edit the pipeline. And in the pipeline here, We have triggers option, just do enable continuous integration and that's it, just save it. And let me show you that the pipeline is automatically starting. This is ASP.NET Core CI pipeline project. How do I show you? Go to the pipelines, look at the list of all runs. We have only one run right now. Now go to the command prompt. Maybe here I'll edit my code once again. I'll make some changes. Azure repos CI pipeline. Close it after saving. Same story, git add, git commit. And do git push origin master. That's it. And wait, wow, something went wrong. Yes, the conflict. Some other user has actually made changes which this user has not seen. So simply do git pull origin master. Those changes will be pulled. Auto merging has happened because there was no same line overlapping happening. So automatic conflict got resolved. Now push it. So your changes, updates are rejected because the tip of your current branch is behind. It's okay. The problem is I made some changes direct online. Oh, here also you see git merge failed, fix conflicts. So there is some editing which I have done which has actually resulted in conflict. I did not notice this. Fine. What we will do is we will edit this file, resolve the conflict and then push the changes. Okay. The conflict will be displayed to us. I resolve and I say, okay, this is the latest. I want to move this. Between this and this, there is a conflict. I'll say, accept current changes. Cool. Save it. Close it. But we'll have to again do staging. We'll have to again commit the changes. Now do git push origin master. The master branch has to be updated. Now there is no conflict. Everything got moved into server. Fantastic. Now what? Verify first. Did the changes come here? Yep. But what is important is you see here one new run automatically started. It's automatically running. The pipeline is automatically started with conflict resolved commit. It automatically started. This is called as continuous integration. Automatic starting of the pipeline precisely is continuous integration. What's next? Now that we have the build output, which I'm going to call it as artifact. Yes, I'm skipping those stages where I should bring into the picture unit test cases, perform test, use so many other tools. Maybe I want to do code coverage testing. I want to do vulnerabilities testing. All those steps I'm bypassing here. And I'm directly going to now building a release pipeline. So let's create a new release pipeline now. Guys, we are almost towards the end of the session. Little patience and you'll see how I'm able to make one change on my local machine and you'll see how quickly the whole software goes into the environment, which can be QA, which can be deployment, I mean any environment. So it's asking me, what is the environment in which you want to deploy? So many environments. As of now, I'll choose Azure App Service. That's what is our target. So simply go for Azure App Service. And you may want to give some kind of stage. It's a multi-stage deployment which we want to opt for. So this is the first one. I'll call it as dev. That's it. And here there will be jobs and tasks. The default which is created is good enough. but I need to access my subscription. Hey, remember that the pipeline is going to execute on a machine, and that machine should have permission to deploy to Azure App Service. So for this, we need to have a service connection established, which is connecting to my Azure subscription. I don't have right now any, and that's why nothing is listed. So click on Manage, create a service connection. I want to connect to Azure Resource Manager. Click on Next. Multiple options are available, but right now I'll choose Automatic. I am using the same account for Azure and for DevOps, so that's why no problem at all. Azure subscription connection. And here we choose the subscription in which we are smallconcern.com. Very good. Why did I get? The default service connection is not coming up. So I may have to actually, let's see, go through a roundabout process to build up a connection. I'm already logged in with same account. Actually, it should have come. Let's see. Sandeep Soni at the rate. Techinsult.com. Something wrong with the subscription I have. Okay, so I'll do one thing. I'll go to project settings. First, let us save this. Save button is not enabled. Okay, that's fine. We'll just go to project settings. Create a service connection from here and see if that works. Looks like something wrong with my Azure subscription. Cool. Okay, I'll do one thing. 26A. I'll get into that subscription only. Portal.azure.com. It is picking up a wrong 26A. Little surprised though why it is doing this mistake. Let me do one thing. One more option I have. I'll do everything in a This is the problem because of multiple subscriptions I have in different accounts. So I'm back in the same project in an incognito window. To avoid that conflict, I did that. I hope it goes to the right subscription now. If not, there is a roundabout procedure. We'll have to go to Azure Active Directory, create a service principal, capture the details of service principal, give permissions to the service principal. So many things will happen in background actually. I want to avoid all those things in this particular demo. I wanted to pick up F9BA. Now it has picked up correctly actually, F9BAE. Pray that it comes out good. Cool. F9BAE. Let us verify. F9BAE, the same subscription where I created my app service. Good. The issue resolved. Yeah, there is another way also, but I didn't want to get into that. My webinar demo RG, and I'll call this subscription as Azure Connection. That's it. Save it. Cool. Oh, get access token failed, identity, AD return silent failure, not working. Something wrong with Azure DevOps. Manage service connection. But anyhow, service connection is created. This is what I wanted. What I'll do now is go to my project. Pipeline, I want to create release pipeline. That pipeline was not saved, so I have to recreate it now. Doesn't take time, quite fast. Cool. Not listing. If this step doesn't work, guys, these are not complicated steps. Let me clarify. I'm just trying to take a shortcut and that became long cut. Okay, doesn't look like a solution easy. I'll take the roundabout approach then. I'll do it in the real time. How do you do it? I'll take that route now. So I go to DevOps, my subscription. Cool. Go to Azure AD. In Azure AD, I'll do an app registration. And application ID. I need a secret. I don't want to explain these steps. I'm being forced to do it. But this is how you should do it in real time. There are a lot of subject behind this actually. The tenant, subscription name, the subscription ID. I wanted to avoid all this copying and pasting, but verify. Good. I go to the subscription, access control, add role assignment, search here, DevOps. Wow. Give the permission, come back here, perfect. Now do the verify. Cool. Give a service connection name, Azure DevOps, Azure MPN connection. Verify and save. Fantastic. So all these connections are useless. I didn't want to go through the manual process. Yes, there are steps which I definitely don't want to explain in this session, because that itself is a like 1 hour explanation. You need to understand Azure Active Directory, you need to understand service principle, you need to understand role-based access control, but precisely that is how it is done in real time. The problem which I got is only because I have multiple subscriptions and I'm logging into multiple accounts. It's conflicting actually. Anyways, all stories apart, now we have got a Azure MPN subscription, and I would like to use this at the time of creating my pipeline. So go ahead, create a release pipeline, new release pipeline. Apply. Let's call this as dev task. It should appear here automatically. Azure MPN connection, fantastic. In that connection, what is the app service to which we want to deploy? I would like to deploy first to the dev. First step, save it. Over. I'll go to the pipeline, add here the artifact, select here. I'm doing, the artifact is supposed to be taken from here. That's what is the configuration. Source build pipeline, source alias, right? And then say add, click here, continuous deployment trigger. By default, it's disabled, I'll enable it. Close it. And now save it. At least what we can do is, before I proceed further and add more stages, I would like to complete the demo till here first. So go to my Azure, look at the app services. This is where we are deploying right now. And right now the content on this website is the default content. This has to be replaced with our website content. How will I do this? One option is I run the pipeline manually. I do here create release, and that runs it manually. Alternatively, as I told you earlier, you can always edit the code. With the moment you check in the code, CI pipeline and now CD pipeline. Save it, check in the code, git add, git commit, cd pipeline, do git push origin master, cool guys. That's it, watch here first, the CI pipeline is automatically started. Whenever this CI pipeline completes, you'll note that my CD pipeline will automatically start. I'm doing nothing. I've just from my local machine pushed the content to Azure repo. And this is continuous integration demo. Finished. You'll notice that release pipeline has automatically started. See, release has automatically started. Go to release, you'll see now. You have a release pipeline already queued up. Agent is ready for the job. Click on logs, you can even see the logs. It's connecting to the agent. And when completed, you'll notice that the deployment to app service has completed. Running on agent, download artifacts from the drop artifact is downloaded from this run. Deploying to Azure App Service. Yes, definitely your web app should be already created when you are doing this. If your web app is not there, where are you publishing? Finish. Almost finish. You will receive an error when writing files to this directory. That's okay, that's a warning. Cool, finish. Go and refresh the page. This is the old page. Happily refresh it. And fantastica. Over. What is the effort I put? I only made a change here and I pushed the content. Finish. One command. Executed everything in the background. Where is the code right now getting published to? First, it's going to only the CI pipeline right now. is, sorry, CD pipeline is right now published only to the dev. Go back to the pipeline, edit the pipeline. Maybe from dev, if everything is okay, you would like to have a approval enabled. Some users should approve it. I don't have multiple users added to the organization, so I'm adding myself here. Within 30 days, I should approve it. All those configurations are there. There is some concept of gates, auto deploy. So many options are available. But my requirement is I would like to clone this and create one more environment, that's UAT. In UAT also, we need an approval. Finally, I would like to clone this also. This is my prod. But something very important, in prod, it should be two-step process. But before that, I should go to my app service. And here, I would like to add a new slot. A deployment slot has to be added. Right now, there is only one slot. I'm going to add a staging slot here. Add it. As this is creating, I see one good question. Can we have a pipeline to create web app within the pipeline? Actually, there is something called as ARM template. So you can have a task which is going to run ARM template, and this ARM templates are the ones which are responsible for creating Azure infrastructure. Through ARM template, you can create an app service. Right now, we are creating the app service manually. But this itself can be automated. The creation of the environment itself can be automated. So we have a staging. So first, what I'm going to do is deploy the app service. Now I would like to not deploy in dev, but I want to deploy to production. And coming to the step here, I want to deploy to slot. Choose the resource group, and the slot I want is staging. So first it is deploying to a staging slot. After deploying to the staging slot, I would like to add a task which will perform swap. Web app swap task. Or you can take Azure App Service Manage. And in this Azure App Service Manage, I would like to swap it. Same connection, app service name, resource group, we have only one, swap it. Source is staging, swap it with production. Fantastic. So first I'm publishing to the staging slot and swapping it into the production. This gives the benefit of zero downtime. Very important. But before I run this, okay, there's one more small error right now. Let me rectify that. I go to the pipeline. In UAT, I did a clone. So when I did a clone, it's submitting to dev. We want it to go into UAT. Because of the clone, we had that. Save it. So yes, go back to the pipeline. We have an approval required. After dev, we have an approval required. After production, you can actually add over here between this and this one more step. Let's say I add something called as human intervention. Not there. Okay, that is in CI pipeline. Mm-hmm. not there, guys. So excuse me on that. I wanted to actually have a human intervention between these two, but I remember that being there. How come it's missing? All. Oh, that's a agentless job. Agentless job. This is agentful job. So we'll not get it here. Either I run on separate agent. Yep. Add an agent. And here we can have. No. It should be agentless job. In agentless job, we can have human intervention. Not there. I think they. Agentless job used to have it. Oh, sorry. It's not human. It's manual intervention. It's manual intervention. So can I get it here itself? Is it possible? Manual. No. No. So you have a choice. You can actually put this task. You can do something like this. You put a manual intervention here and move this into the last one. Agentless job and add that here. You can always do that. So yes, I'm not doing it. We are fine with what we have to keep the simple demo. But when I demonstrate a real-time project deployment, I do take care of that also. So we are good with this and save it. You can either create a release manually or, as usual, you can follow the procedure. First, go to the pipeline. Let's see the final demo now. And everything in action at one place. Code dot. Everything I change. Welcome to Azure DevOps. With automated CI and CD pipeline. Save it. Close this. Git add. Git commit. Final demo. I need little patience of yours, guys. I know it has been long time, but you're about to see the climax. Git push origin master and no more interaction. No more interaction. Oh, conflict. Let's resolve git pull origin master conflict because I choose wrong window. I should have taken this window. I took this window. We have a conflict. Okay. Let's resolve the conflict. Let's not worry about all these problems. These are routine day-to-day activities. So I am fine with current changes. Save it. Close it. Git add. Git commit. Git push. Cool. Fantastic. Wait. Did the pipeline? It has to start the run automatically. Fantastic. Run has started. Wow. Let the run complete. This is a CI pipeline in execution. Let the run complete. As soon as the run is complete, we'll have release. One more release started. Now it has three environments. Basically three stages in the pipeline. Go to release watch first. We'll wait for dev to complete. Why Azure is DevOps is take flying. This is the reason, no human interaction. How fast I'm able to do? Otherwise, imagine if we are not using DevOps, what is the procedure? We have to go for manual procedure for all this, which will take sometimes days and weeks and months. We don't want to get into the trap of a manual process. As soon as this is completed, we will test it in the dev environment. This is the dev environment. Once my dev is completed, I would also like to test it in my UAT. After UAT, I would like to also test it in the production. These are still the older versions, as you can see. We don't have anything in UAT yet. We don't have anything in production. Dev is also the old. But we are waiting for the pipeline to complete. And as soon as the pipeline is complete, guys, you will see approval needed. For what? Post-deployment. That is fine. But right now, come to the dev, refresh. Welcome to Azure DevOps with automated CI and CD pipeline. Fantastic. It's ready. Let the development team test it thoroughly. And then comes the team lead. Actually, a mail should have already gone to the team lead. If I check my mail, I'll have a mail that I need an approval. So I come here. I come to the pipeline. In the mail also, I'll have a link. I come to the release pipeline. From there, I can directly jump here. And it says approval waiting. I am authorized to approve. So I approve it. Give my comment. I am perfect with the changes. I am happy with the changes. Approve it. Gone. And you will notice a UAT pipeline is already started. 30 days it will wait maximum. That's the default value actually. Once the UAT pipeline completes, finally deploying to UAT now. Here. I should really appreciate the patience. I see around 217 people in the session at this point of time. And definitely I see 49 likes. Can I deserve more? I would say this is one of my best sessions so far. Perfect. UAT is completed. Verify. Refresh it. The user acceptance testing will be done. They say we are happy. They come to the site. Maybe the member from the organization of the client, customer, he will come and approve it. And as soon as he approves it, you will see that the production version has started. It's now going to deploy into the production. We are almost there, almost there. What I have to show you, the product has gone into life. And what was the effort? I just built the project and I committed on my machine. Yes, guys, this is one of the very, 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 very basic example, which probably I can show it to anyone who wants to appreciate DevOps. You can do the whole process in a more complicated and more advanced way. Definitely, there is a big learning curve around it. You need to have a lot of process build. DevOps is only executing the process, but the process has to be built by the people. People have to be ready to follow the process. So there are a lot of sessions which I have conducted in the past about what exactly is Azure DevOps, what exactly is in general DevOps, how should DevOps be. I would want you to watch the YouTube videos of mine. There are some playlists created. You can just watch them. DevOps playlist is there. You can watch them. They are fantastically explaining the importance of Azure DevOps in a career of a software developer or in career of a IT administrator, operations team, and how these two teams come together and create or evolve a role called as DevOps. You see, a deployment to slot is completed, and now it is finally swapping it. Advantage of swapping is it is not going to have any downtime. This is also called as blue-green deployment. So there are many terms I know by decision. I have not gone into the explanation, but those are all something which is going to take time. We kept it away from this particular session. I just wanted to demonstrate the power, how things happen. Of course, we were stuck at one place where I had the connection issues, but that's not DevOps problem. That's the problem with my configuration of the Azure subscriptions. And as soon as this is completed, you know, the production version also will be ready. We have to just wait, finish. The site is now live into production. Very basic Jujube example is what I have shown to you. But trust me, for the first timer, this can be the best life cycle of an Azure DevOps application. I've tried my best to document the steps also. You can probably get this by putting a request in the WhatsApp group from wherever you got the link to join this particular session. Send a request. My team will probably reply to you in a private window with this particular document. So we completed Azure DevOps automation of building and deploying .NET Core application, a beginning to end journey. I would definitely want to take some questions. Oh, big list which I could not. Name, class, 10th class, name. What is this? What is the advantage of AKS? Oh, that's it. I have some sessions done on AKS also. Look into my playlist. You'll find it there. You're amazing, sir. Thank you. Thank you for the compliment. Definitely, I would request some of you people here to leave your comments in the chat session. That would be kind of motivation for us and my team about the returns which you are giving us in terms of the appreciation. And if anything, negative feedback, please feel free to write. We will positively take it and we will improve upon it. Honestly, no developer people required separately. As far as Azure DevOps considered, it is not that difficult. I have seen mostly developers like .NET developers forced to learn DevOps. No, nobody is forced to learn DevOps. If you want to grow in your career, you need to keep learning. Only learning probably can grow. Don't learn, don't grow, and you get stagnated. So don't ever make a judgment about the product. It's not fair unless you have complete deep knowledge about it. DevOps fits into the BI, an excellent BI. If you are creating a Azure pipeline, what do you call that? Azure Data Factory has DevOps now. Power BI is going to have DevOps. So a lot of Microsoft tools have already started integrating with DevOps. And rather, you should know, anything which can go into the repository can be managed by DevOps. Great teaching, never saw such simple tool, CI/CD. Can we deploy Azure Web App within the pipeline? I have already answered that before. In the real scenario, how can we change the connection string of an application? Guys, definitely I know there is a lot of questions about how you want to bring database into the session. Yes, I would want to take a separate session on how I can probably bring a web application with an SQL database and set up the whole thing through Azure DevOps. We have to follow a procedure. It's not that simple and straightforward. We definitely need to follow a particular procedure. How you should make changes, how to handle a database project, how the changes to the schema has to be reflected. All this has to again go through a complete process. So you can contact my team, get into our WhatsApp groups. You will definitely get to know a future session on Azure DevOps with app services and SQL database handled in a CI/CD pipeline. Kindly provide some information about artifacts. I tried searching online, but artifacts seems to be a bit. Artifacts is basically different types of artifacts. The published output of an application is called as an artifact. So if you have published, not published, sorry, output of a CI pipeline. It's here. The output which comes from the project is called as an artifact. The build output. When I build, I get an artifact. When I complete the steps of build, there is one agent machine which is used in background. After the steps are executed, the agent machine got destroyed. So whatever has been published here, that should be saved. That we saved in the artifact. To a file container at so and so place. And this artifact is managed by my DevOps. These artifacts are different. These are DevOps artifacts. These are basically your reusable components which you want to use it in your projects. So these are definitely different. So there are two different things. Azure DevOps is still all about CI/CD pipeline. No, if you people who have joined my session late, I would request you to watch this complete session from the beginning, where I have actually explained to you what is Azure DevOps and a complete life cycle. This whole thing has been explained in the beginning of the session. So please revisit this particular video. It will be available to you on the YouTube, and you should be able to watch and let me know your feedback on this also. Does it require a separate CI/CD for DevOps and prod and separate CD for? You can actually do. I have done everything in a single CD. Single CD pipeline I have done. If you want to have separate deployment cycle, you may want to go for separate deployment pipeline. You can do that. You can have one branch created on probably your UAT and, one pipeline can be created on a UAT and a separate pipeline can be created for production. That's what is all part of the DevOps branching policies and deployment policies which you are going to build in your organization. So yes, you have to decide on all these things. Guys, there is a small survey which we have posted, small link. My humble request to you to take out a couple of minutes. I've already taken 2 hours of session for you almost. So my request to you would be at least give us feedback using the link which we have provided in the chat session. Humble request. I know a lot of people don't even bother to give feedback, but that's the way we can actually improve our quality and reach and provide more content to you people. So do we need to Azure migrations? Many times asked this question. Azure migration is a different story. Azure migration is all about moving your on-premise infrastructure into Azure. That's a completely different story. You use something called as Azure Migrate service for that. You can migrate your VMs, you can migrate your database, everything can be migrated, your workloads can be migrated from on-premise into Azure. Guys, if you have done your feedback form, please mention that you are done. That will help us. You just mention in the text, done. Please feel free to post your comments on how was this particular session. And also, I would request you to forward the link to this particular session with your friends, because this is something very, very confusing topic in the industry. The reason I'm taking this particular session is a lot of people have confusion about what is DevOps, what can it do, what it cannot do. I see a lot of questions even after having complete session today about how the DevOps end-to-end lifecycle is. Yes, they cannot be answered in one short session. Yes, definitely I am a trainer by profile. In case you are interested, you can opt for my full course. I do a lot of live training also. You can go to best.nettraining.com, and over here we have got a complete course compiled by me. Around 30 hours of course this is, and it's only going to grow with time. So you may want to subscribe to this particular course. I leave it to you to decide. Also, we have, guys, one contribution done by DeccanSoft team, AzureA2Z.com. AzureA2Z.com is where you can actually find a lot of exams. Right now we are working on 104, 900. Very soon we will come up with the certification exam questions on lot of other modules also. We have module wise questions here. Then we have done also a complete set. So if you are planning to go for certification exam, this can be a good hands-on experience before you get into the exam. Some tips and tricks of handling the certification you can find. Lot of interview questions our team is preparing on various topics. You can learn about it. So as the name goes, Azure A to Z, you can also see lot of videos of mine which are here on YouTube and many more. I would request you to subscribe to the playlist. You will also find here a lot of events which Microsoft conducts. You can find here. All these are different events Microsoft is conducting. So you should definitely look at these and be in touch. You have the jobs postings. Yeah, we are not seeing many people using it. So we have toned down a bit on this, but few important jobs we are still posting for the people across. They can just come here, view more. They can go to the respective job portal and figure out if it is in LinkedIn, if it is different places. There's a team of people which is contributing to this site. So definitely a very big contribution from DeccanSoft to the Azure community. I would request you to look at this. We also have a mobile app version now available in the playlist where we only give interview questions right now. But we are upgrading this also. We will give a lot of extra features in the mobile app too. But to begin with, it's just interview questions which is provided there. Oh, I believe you are satisfied. Yeah, you can reach me anytime for any of the questions you may have. You can find on screen my email ID. That's my name, Sandeep Soni. My phone number, I'm in India, 01840. I'm also available on WhatsApp. I would once again request you to join our WhatsApp groups. In case you don't have any WhatsApp group membership, ping me, I'll share the link. Using that, you can join the WhatsApp group. And any kind of personal guidance you need, career guidance you need, please feel free to call me anytime. I'm available today. I'm free tomorrow also, anytime today, tomorrow. Call me in case I don't pick up, I generally call back. So yes, my team has already given the link to the WhatsApp group chat. You can join that in case you're interested to more details and more upcoming webinars from DeccanSoft. Signing out. Thank you for all your patience. I definitely know this was a very long session, but I feel it could be very useful to you also. Thank you. Bye-bye. Take care.